Hi,
I'm Dr. Shikha Verma, Medical Advisor for Lupin Oncology. Lupin is an innovation-led transnational pharmaceutical company and is one among top five Indian pharma companies. And we pride in belonging to an industry which makes the difference in lives of people. On behalf of Lupin, I welcome you all for today's webinar. The topic of webinar is updates in CML, and the speaker for the session is Dr. Rajeev Vijayakumar. Dr. Rajeev is a consultant medical and hemato-oncologist and BMT physician currently attached to BGS Global Hospital, Bangalore. He has done his postdoctoral DMB in medical oncology from Army Hospital Research and Referral Center, New Delhi, and he has a thriving experience of over 10 years, which includes management of complex cancers. His expertise includes lymphoma, breast cancer, lung cancer, and autologous stem cell transplant. His special area of interest includes precision medicine using genetic sequencing to provide treatment options for various cancers. He has multiple peer-reviewed publications to his credit and received multiple awards at various national and international conferences. We welcome you, Doctor. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. I'd like to thank Lupin Oncology for inviting me to do this CME on CML. So basically, there's been a huge barrage of webinars which have been going, but I can promise the viewers that it's going to be crisp. I'm going to talk about basic to the regular doctor, to the physician, how to identify a CML, what are the drugs that are commonly used, we'll talk about the chronic phase, we'll talk about the accelerated phase, blast phase, what are the criteria we have to diagnose, what are the scores that we have for prognostication, and then after which we will also be talking about the treatment options that we have. So let's go ahead and please feel free to put questions on the question box. We'd be very happy to answer them. And so I am Dr. Rajeev Vijayakumar. Like Dr. Hashika had mentioned, I work at Bangalore at BGS Gleneagles Global Hospital, Bangalore. I also do an OPD at TS Medical College, Kuppam. So where we run the Department of Oncology in association with the physicians and the surgeons at PS Medical College, Kuppam. So now introducing CML. CML is a myeloproliferative neoplasm. Where here, this is a condition where you have a dysregulated, regulated production and uncontrolled proliferation of mature and maturing granulocytes along with normal differentiation. What we'll have to understand is there is normal differentiation has occurred. If it is in the completely immature cells which are going, then it becomes into blasts, then it is called an acute leukemia. That's why here it is, because it's all well differentiated, it's called a chronic leukemia. Chronic myelogenous leukemia, because it's all the neutrophils and the basically the granulocytes. What happens, there's a fusion of two genes. I'm sure everyone knows that BCR-ABL, the Philadelphia chromosome. So there's the BCR is there on chromosome number 22. I'll show you the picture. And then the Abelson gene, Abelson 1 is on chromosome 9. They both fuse together. And then there's a driver mutation which occurs. Therefore, there is the tyrosine kinase. Tyrosine kinase is the driver. So that keeps, it gives a signal to the cell that proliferate. And cell keeps proliferating. So this is the image. So I can just show you here. Now this is the Abelson gene, which is there on chromosome 9. And then this is BCR. What is BCR? It is breakpoint cluster region. So this is like a driver. So this is like an accelerator. So the Abelson gene, that what will happen is the Abelson gene breaks apart and comes and attaches over here to the chromosome number 22. So with this, you have a driver which is there on behind the proliferating signal, that is the Abelson gene. So therefore the BCR gives signals to the Abelson that proliferate. So the protein product which is formed out of this would go and continuously keep stimulating the receptor tyrosine kinase and keep on giving signals to continue the production of the WBCs, mainly the myeloid line. So how frequently do we see it? It's seen around 1 to 2 cases per lakh population. It accounts for 15 to 20% of all the adult leukemias. As we age, the chances become more, and around 85 to 90% of our patients would present in the chronic phase. So what would they come with? They'll come with heaviness because of the splenic enlargement. So around 5 to 10% of these patients would progress to accelerate phase or blast cases, and then they would succumb to that. They can also develop some amount of infections, and they could succumb to the infections as well. So many patients would be picked up on a routine blood examination, so that they just go for a regular test, or they're going for a pre-op evaluation, and then you found to have a high count. Some people might get admitted for an appendicitis surgery and being found to have a high count. So 50% of CML patients are asymptomatic at diagnosis. So what are the three phases? We have three phases: chronic, accelerated phase, and blast crisis. So normally when the CML presents, for 5 to 6 years, it is in the chronic phase. If untreated, it will go into the accelerated phase. And this lasts for around 6 to 8 months. And after which, if yet untreated, it then goes into the blast crisis. Very rarely will you find a patient who presents to you with blast crisis. These would mimic Kana as a regular acute myeloid leukemia. So we'll have to be cognizant of that. So in this now, this diagram is actually it's a good self-explanatory diagram. So in the chronic phase, patients, most of them would be asymptomatic. So they can come with enlarged spleen, or they could, that even in the accelerated phase it's mentioned here, but even in the chronic phase, patients can come with pain in the abdomen, or distension, or a disturbance in the abdomen. So if you see the blasts, they would be slightly more than 10%, because normally up to 6 to 8% blasts are normal in the bone marrow. So if you have 10 to 15% blasts, then afterwards it will be come into the definition of chronic phase. In the accelerated phase, you'll have around 15 to 30% blasts. And if it's more than 30% blasts, the definition shifts over to blast phase. So in the blast phase, patients can also come with extramedullary disease. They can come with, we call that myeloid sarcoma. They can come with any deposits either on the skin, or on the face, or on the bone, and they can have pressure symptoms due to that, because of which the patient would present. Or they could even come with a mass in the abdomen. So, and then you do biopsy, and then that comes as a myeloid sarcoma. Sarcoma is not just, it is a muscle tumor, but it you have sheets of cells which look like the myeloid cells. Then these would be MPO positive. So then after the clinical phase, so in the CP, clinical CML CP, the symptoms are very minimal. In the accelerated phase, it's slightly bit more, and then afterwards in the blast phase, it becomes furthermore. So what will your patients can present? Apart from being asymptomatic, they can come with recurrent infections. Chest infections is the most common. They can come with pneumonias. They can come with fungal infections when you won't expect them to have. And then afterwards, if their platelets have gone low, if it's gone into the accelerated phase, then you can have signs and symptoms of low platelets, like bleeding or any bleeding diseases. Rarely do you find people with lymphomas. Lymphomas generally won't get to see. But in the accelerated phase, you may be able to see that. So how do you diagnose a CML? So basically, if you have a patient who comes with high counts, once you get high counts, you should look at the differential count. The differential count, what you look for? You look for neutrophils, lymphocytes, and basophils. So in CML, important thing to the trick here is normal. What is the normal basophil count? It is less than around 1 to 1.5%. In CML, the basophil count would be somewhere around 8 to 10%. Once you see that, you immediately should trigger something in your head. Oh, there's so much of basophils. It could be that there is a possibility of CML. Okay, the count is beyond 30,000, 40,000. Okay, patient has no other symptoms. And you will find there will be neutrophil predominance. You have a large amount of neutrophils. So this, along with basophilia, you have to keep thinking of CML. Then, this would be the typical findings in the blood. The bone marrow will again find excess of more amount of blasts. You'll be able to find that. Do you need to do a bone marrow biopsy? This is a common question that we would have in any patient with a CML. Is it necessary to do a bone marrow biopsy? Actually, it is not necessary for treatment, but it is necessary because you want to look for the amount of fibrosis, because this is a myeloproliferative neoplasm. It can also present, it could be a feature of impending myelofibrosis as well. So you need to look for the reticulin stain to see for how much myelofibrosis exists in the baseline. With therapy, over a period of 2 years, the myelofibrosis may increase. So it is imperative for us to do bone marrow only for that. It is not for the diagnosis of CML. So we also need to do detection of the Philadelphia chromosome. That is, you look for the BCR ABL1 gene. How can you do this? You can do the regular, you can look for the chromosome analysis. What you do, you take, give a sample of blood, and then you can do cytogenetics. It's called karyotyping. You look for all the 46 chromosomes, and you look at 9, which has become smaller, and 22, which has become bigger. So in that, you know that, okay, there has been a translocation that has occurred. That is your conventional cytogenetic analysis or karyotyping. Or what else can you do? You can also do FISH. You put a probe which will go directly and attach to the BCR, that is breakpoint cluster region, on chromosome 22, and it will attach to the Abelson gene. So in a normal cell, you will find both of them separate. In a cell with BCR allele where there is a translocation, there you will find both the green and the red signal will come together and it will look yellow. That's how it will be. Then after, you can also do RT-PCR. Now, RT-PCR is what we do in clinical practice, because that also gives us the very good, it tells us what is the load of the disease as well. So what are the other hematological tests? We keep doing tests in between. After starting therapy, we do tests at every month for up to 3 months. Then subsequently, we do a 3 month, 6 month, and then afterwards 9th month and 12th month. Our timelines are 3, 6, and 12, where we would actually, we look for the complete hematological response. We do the cytogenetic tests, and then we do the molecular tests again. The molecular tests that we mentioned are reverse real-time, RT-PCR, reverse transcriptase PCR that we do. So that's basically to look for how much is the log fall in the BCR ABL level. We use something called international standardized ratio. IS ratio is seen because each kit would be different in each different hospital to ensure, like how we have PTINR. Similarly, in the doing by checking for BCR ABL, you have something called as IS, international standardized ratio. So this ratio is what you will have to pick. It is not the number of copies that is detected. You will have, that report will typically have what is the amount of BCR seen and what is the amount of BCR ABL that is seen. So that forms a ratio. Right? Then you check it out with that. So what are the goals of treatment of CML? You want to achieve hematological, I'm just showing you this. So response milestones. So now this is the BCR ABL1 international standardized ratio, which is there. So by 3 months, there should have been a one log fall. Even if you consider it to be 100% of the thing, it generally is around 70-80% in many patients that you would see. Even if it should fall below 10, at 3 months when you do your BCR ABL, it should fall below 10%. If it is not falling below 10%, that means to say it is in the yellow range. That means to say that probably your drug is not working as well as you want it to. You might either have to increase the dose of the drug that you're giving, that is either imatinib or dasatinib or nilotinib, whichever you're using. And we have to keep checking the patient on a regular basis. If it comes under, at the end of 6 months, if it is more than 10%, it is a treatment failure. So that means you say that this drug is not working, you have to change it. So when you see this, suppose your BCR ABL falls between 1% and 10% at the end of 3 months, you are very happy. So that means say that your drug is working. By 6 months, you want a 2-log reduction. So if it has become from 100, it's become 10. From 10, it should become around 1. So that's what you will look at over here. So if it is at the end of 1 year, if it is yet, or at the end of 6 months, if it is yet more than 1%, then you are not very comfortable. It again falls in the yellow range. It has to be less than 1%. At the end of a year, it should have been less than 0.1%. So that's the dictums that we have. And beyond a year and all throughout the treatment, it should be less than 0.1%. Then you have also, you have MMR, and you want 10 to the power of minus 4 as well, where you want to see it's like less than 0.0001%. That means you say that you've actually achieved very deep molecular response. So this is just again a criteria which you are there. For imatinib is a drug that I'm sure that all of you are aware, which is the common drug which is used for CML since 2001. This is one of the major discoveries where it was called the targeted magic bullet or targeted therapy, which went and just killed the CML and got it under control. Before that, the therapy for CML, you'd be surprised to know that now everyone, most of us think the treatment for CML is only tablet. Before that, it was a very poor prognostic. If you found BCR able, it means to say that the patient's not going to survive beyond 3 to 6 months. And allogeneic transplant was the only way to treat these patients before, as recently as 2000, the year 2000. So over here, so now the goals of treatment of CML. So hematological remission is the CBC becomes normal. Your hemoglobin, to platelet, WBC, everything becomes normal. There should be no organ hemoglobin. So it is very important that every time you follow the patient with CML, you have to look for pallor ictus and all that. Along with it, you should also look for splenomegaly. Splenomegaly should not be present. Cytogenetic remission, it's a normal chromosome. When you do the karyotyping, normal chromosome with 0% Philadelphia chromosome positive cells. Molecular remission, this is the important part, which we just discovered. That is the international ratio, IS ratio, which is done by RT-PCR. Here, this is what we described, where it should become less than 10% after 3 months, and after 6 months it should be less than 1%, and after a year it should be less than 0.1%. If you are reaching this, then afterwards your treatment is successful. Complete cytogenetic remission is a major determinant of CML outcome, regardless of whether major molecular response has been achieved or not. So that's also very important. So even if you have your BCR-ABL, which is not seen on karyotyping, that itself is a very good prognostic indicator. The best thing is that we want is molecular remission. So the therapeutic options are now TKI, then chemotherapy. Which type of chemotherapy will we use? If a patient presents with accelerated phase or blast crisis, there you will be treating the patient with drugs which you use for regular AML, acute myeloid leukemia. So interferons were used in the past, but we don't use them anymore. And they also had a very good response rate, but albeit with a large amount of side effects. Stem cell transplant was used for almost every other patient who could afford it. But in this particular era, we are using it for people who have failed TKIs. But again, we have multiple lines of TKIs. First generation drugs like imatinib, then second generation drugs like dasatinib, nilotinib, then afterwards ponatinib, then you have bosutinib, which has now come, then afterwards you have radotinib, asiminib. These are all new. And so if the patient has failed all these lines, then you take them up for transplant. And you don't do autologous transplant, you do allogenic, the matched sibling donor transplant. So this is just a flowchart to describe what we had just mentioned. So after you start with one of the TKIs, mainly imatinib, then if you're not having a good response, then you do dose escalation. You're giving 400 milligrams once daily, you make it 100 milligrams twice daily, and you keep checking. If you're losing your cytogenetic response, major cytogenetic response, then after what you will do is you do your BCR-ABL mutation analysis. This is called IRMA, Imatinib Resistant Mutation Analysis, IRMA. It's called IRMA. So you do this, and if there is a loss, in the sense that if you find that there were certain mutations which have developed, like if you can see here, this T315I, if that mutation has occurred, then you put these patients on particular drugs or you put them on clinical trials. And if you're not able to find any particular mutation, you go on to the second generation drugs. You can go on to dasatinib or nilotinib or ponatinib. And then afterwards, these patients would again give you few years to few months in different patients. You can keep extending his life. And yet, if the patient worsens, then you go in for a transplant. And after, if you started on imatinib and the patient is worsening on it, at some point of time, the patient might go into a blast crisis or an accelerated phase. You'll have to give him regular chemotherapy, like how you treat an acute myeloid leukemia, and then take him up for a transplant. So let's have now today's topic of discussion. We're talking about tyrosine kinase inhibitors. So what is a tyrosine kinase inhibitor? So now this is a very interesting thing. We've heard a lot about TKI, but what exactly is TKI? Just let's get into it. Now, TKIs are see, now you have a cell, and then after you have a, on top of the membrane of the cell, you have a extracellular domain of the receptor. In, then you have a intramembranous part of the receptor, and then you have intracellular. So you have a cell, and then you have a receptor sitting on it. So then afterwards, inside the receptor, like if you're saying this is the extracellular domain, you have a transmembrane domain, and then you have a cytosolic domain, that is intracellular. This thing that you, what you're seeing here is called the tyrosine kinase. Now you will have ATPs over here, you'll have like four or five dots over here, where this is like a key, or this is like a catalyst, or this is, if you can say that this is like a something to kickstart the reaction. That's what this tyrosine kinase does. So it's an enzyme can transfer a phosphate group from ATP to a protein inside our cells. It's basically, it's like switching on the cell. Once you have the ligand coming over here and attaching to this, then what happens? These are all like floating receptors. Once some ligand attaches over here like this, then both of these domains over here, these would come together. And once they come together, it is like a boy and girl get together, then there is a spark. Similarly over here, there would be a spark over here and activity would occur. And once this gets activated, there is a transfer of ATP. This is called phosphates. Kinases means transfer of phosphate atom. So once this occurs, this gets activated. And once this gets activated, there is a downstream pathway which would get activated. Now, what can this downstream pathway do? If it is a ligand for, if you say for growth, it starts growing. If it is a ligand to say reduce the cell growth, it will stop reducing that. If it wants to make a protein, it will make a protein. If it wants to cause apoptosis, it will cause apoptosis. So there are multiple actions depending on what kind of ligand comes and what is the receptor conformation that occurs. So now basically what they realized is that you have, these are the ligands which are coming here. So you have a receptor tyrosine kinase. So this is the tyrosine kinase and this is the receptor tyrosine kinase. If you block this, you have drugs like imatinib and second generation, third generation, they would all come into the cell and block the receptor over here at this area. They don't come and block it, not the external component, not the extracellular domain. They come into the intracellular domain and block this regulatory domain. Once this is blocked, the next cascading pathway is stopped. So you have our receptor tyrosine kinase family includes receptors for insulin, epidermal growth factor, fibroblast growth factor, platelet derived growth factor, VGF, and then afterwards SRC, Janus kinase, Abelson gene, etc. So now this is just like this slide. I want to just tell you all regarding how targeted therapy has evolved over the few last two decades. Rituximab was one of the first targeted therapies which came, which is anti-CD20. I'm sure you all know about that, where we use it for drugs like for diseases like non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, B-cell non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. We use it for follicular lymphoma. We use it for CLL. Then afterwards, then came the superstar imatinib, or Gleevec as it is called, in 2001, where this was used for the first time in CML, and they realized it was a fantastic response. All the patients who were receiving transplant, and CML was considered to be a dreaded disease, suddenly overnight most patients were almost on the verge of cure and having a normal life. Then in 2007 came dasatinib, nilotinib, gefitinib. I'm sure you all know it is for EGFR mutant lung cancers. Erlotinib 2 is also the same. Then you have lapatinib, which is for HER2. I'm sure you heard of trastuzumab. Something similar to that is lapatinib, which is an oral anti-HER2 agent. Sunitinib, all these NIBs become very confusing, but sunitinib is for kidney cancer, renal cell carcinoma. Sorafenib is for hepatocellular carcinoma. So you have anything that ends with NIB is actually a tyrosine kinase inhibitor. Anything which ends with MAB, M-A-B, like rituximab, bevacizumab, trastuzumab, they are monoclonal antibodies. These are big agents which come and attach to the extracellular domain. Anything which is NIB, it is like size of a NIB, it will go into the cell and attack the intracellular domain. This is for us to understand the difference between a MAB and a NIB. NIBs are all tablets. MABs are most of the times injections. So mechanism of action, they bind to a segment of the domain that fixes the enzyme. So it's basically, it gets into the cell, and like I showed you the diagram over there, it binds that, it prevents that, it comes like kebab mein haddi between those two receptors which come over there, floating receptors, it comes and prevents the fire between the receptors. That's exactly what these tyrosine kinase inhibitors do. So they have a very good oral bioavailability, 98%, so therefore needn't worry about oral absorption. They are highly protein bound and they are eliminated by the gut. So we have first generation in TKIs, which we've seen in CML is imatinib. The second generation TKIs are dasatinib, nilotinib and bosutinib. Bosutinib is like the boss. So they're much more potent inhibitors of BCR-ABL than imatinib. So now what's going to happen if it is more potent? They're going to cause a deeper molecular response. So the goal of TKI therapy is to achieve a complete cytogenetic response within 12 months after first-line TKI. So what they have seen is that the deeper the response, the longer the person survives. The deeper and faster the response. So it is important for us to have a very quick, within 3 months, if you're going to achieve complete cytogenetic response, and if you're going to have very good, what's going to happen is that you're going to have such a deep molecular response that chances of the disease coming back becomes lesser. So that's when the concept of using a second generation TKI upfront, rather than using imatinib, use dasatinib or nilotinib upfront, and you find a much more deeper response. And there are certain times we can even do a drug holiday. We've got such a minimal disease residue that you can actually stop the medicines and observe the patients. Some patients would get away with it and go off the drug. Some patients can skip the drug for a few months to a year, and then afterwards, when the disease slightly starts coming back, you introduce the drug again. So the goal of TKI therapy is to achieve complete cytogenetic response after first-line TKI and to prevent progression into accelerated or blast phases. So what was the need for second generation? What was wrong with imatinib? It was a superstar. Imatinib has relatively low potency and it inhibits targets at micromolecular level rather than nanomolar concentrations. So it's like you have 1+3, then you want 1+3 is very good. You want 1+6, then you want 1+7, then 1+8, 1+8 Pro. That's exactly how these drugs also work. There'll be subtle difference between them both. Both of them would do the work, but there'll be subtle difference between them both and they would do better. So second generation TKIs induce higher rates of early complete cytogenetic response and major molecular response than imatinib. So that's like I was saying, you want a deeper and a faster response. So now here you can see here that you have something called the low risk and high risk. So every patient who comes with a CML, you will have to do risk stratification like all cancers. You don't have stage over here. In the stage here, it's like chronic phase, accelerated phase and blast phase. But on this also, in the CMLCP or CML chronic phase, you also do risk assessment. What are the tools that you have? You might have all heard of something called the SOCAL score, S-O-K-A-L, SOCAL score. Where is that SOCAL score? Okay, I will show you that. You have SOCAL score. And also you have something called UTOS, European Transplant Organization thing. So that, and you also have something called Hasford score. So this, what do these scores take? They take the basophil percentage, they take the WBC count, they take the splenic size. So when you put all of this, it has a huge logarithmic calculation and it dishes out a score. This is like a calculator which is available online. So once you get that score, you can see as with the table whether it is a low risk, intermediate risk or high risk. If it is low risk, then imatinib is enough. If it is high risk, then afterwards you will high risk or intermediate risk, it's better for you to start with a second generation TKI because the first generation TKI is not going to hold on for too long, for 8 months, 9 months max. But in these cases, you want to send your Sachin Sehwag upfront rather than send a bowler or the night watchman to play the major game. So you can see here that in the lowest score, you start off with either the first generation, or you can also go in for bosutinib, dasatinib, or nilotinib, the second generation, if need be. Whereas in intermediate and high risk, it is better for you to start with second generation TKI. So then this is like I was talking to you about IRMA, right? Imatinib resistance mutation analysis. Whenever there is a progression on any particular line of these therapies, you do this resistance mutation analysis, TKI resistance mutation analysis, and then you get these different mutations. And depending on which mutation you get, you can, there's certain, these one of these drugs would be much more sensitive to these mutations than the other, and you use them. Okay. So now the treat, so you also look at patients depending on their treatment, on their comorbidities, you use certain drugs. Like you can see here, imatinib is used for any kind of comorbidity. You can use imatinib. There's no problem. And the other problems, like you can see here now, like nilotinib, you can't use it when the patient has a hypertension, diabetes, because it's going to cause so much more dyslipidemia. It's going to cause so much more uncontrolled sugars. And dasatinib over here is another drug where if you have any pulmonary hypertension or any other, like any lung disease, you prefer less to use it. But in rest of the other comorbidities, dasatinib is a good drug. Ponatinib, you will not be able to use it, or you less preferable to use it in hypertension, diabetes, or any other ischemic heart disease. So now, dasatinib, we will talk about dasatinib for another 5-10 minutes, and then we will go on for the question and answer session. Dasatinib was the first approved for second-line treatment of CML patients post-imatinib failure. Like most of the new drugs, they come as a second line, third line, and then afterwards, then it climbs its way up to as the first line. This Decision trial, after this, dasatinib came as one of the frontline drugs for treatment of CML and people who are imatinib naive, so who have not received imatinib. So in the context of advanced CML, dasatinib can be the choice of TKI a treatment over imatinib and nilotinib. So this also has a good CNS penetration power when compared to the rest of the TKIs. So therefore, even if you have a blast crisis or you have an accelerated phase, dasatinib would be the treatment of choice because it can penetrate through the blood-brain barrier. So there's like, I'm not going to bore you with these trials because, but this is important for you to know that when they initially started off in 2010, so they checked dasatinib versus imatinib in newly diagnosed CML-CP. So basically, I will just come to the conclusion. Dasatinib compared with imatinib administered once daily, it induces significantly higher and faster rates of complete cytogenetic response and maximum molecular response, major molecular response. So since achieving complete cytogenetic response within 12 months is associated with the long-term progression-free survival, dasatinib improves long-term outcomes in patients with newly diagnosed CML-CP. So it's basically, these drugs are like much more superpowers. We use Sachin Sehwag, Ganguly to open the batting. So therefore, you hit it out in your power play overs, you get a good score and you have a very good chance of winning. That's exactly what this drug intends to do. That's the principle of using this superstar drug upfront, any of the second line, dasatinib or nilotinib or bosutinib. So now again, you have another, it's a 5-year study of the Decision. So again, that also showed that this is, if you just see the trial design, they used dasatinib 100 milligrams versus imatinib 400 milligrams. You can look at these complete cytogenetic response and major molecular response between, this blue is the dasatinib and the yellow is the imatinib. It's visible that dasatinib is faring better. Of course, it's a second generation TKI, but imatinib was the original hero. And you can see here, that is regarding the cumulative major molecular response rates over time. At around 5 years also, the dasatinib had a 76% major molecular response when compared to imatinib, which stood at around 64%. The very significant p-value of less than 0.0002. So now this is just basically just all of them reiterating the same thing. So then this is an important slide. Transformation to accelerated phase or blast phase CML by 5 years. if the patients were using dasatinib upfront, there's only 4% or 4.5% chance he would go into a accelerated phase or a blast crisis. If he was using imatinib, there's a 7.5% chance he would go into a blast crisis. So the conclusion was from the DASISION trial was to support dasatinib 100 milligrams once daily, safe, effective first-line therapy for long-term treatment of CMLCP. So then this, I will leave this over here. There's another study which would actually tell about 50 milligrams. So low-dose dasatinib, there's been one lecture by Dr. M.B. Agarwal, the father of hematology in Bombay, and father of hematology, you can call it father of hematology even in India as well. So where instead of 100 milligrams daily, they used 50 milligrams daily of dasatinib, and they found that it was as effective as the 100 milligrams dose. You can see it over here. So dasatinib 50 milligrams is active, well tolerated in patients with newly diagnosed patients with CMLCP. And it's a very, very exciting thing that you're using half the dose and you're getting equivalent response. You can see here that the complete response, now this is with 100 milligrams, 73%. If you're using 50 milligrams, you're getting higher response. It's crazy, but that's exactly how the results are coming out. At the end of 12 months also, if you're using a lesser dose, you're getting a better response. This is something very, very interesting. Higher the dose, we expect better response, but actually in dasatinib, it's changing. These are the latest results and very exciting results. We're using 50 milligrams low dose dasatinib and you're getting a better response, even at the end of 12 years to 12 months as well as 5 years as well. So the conclusions were, the updated results of this particular trial show that 50 milligrams of dasatinib was as effective and safer dose in early CMLCP. So I'll leave this. I'll come to the key takeaways. This is the last slide. Dasatinib can be used as a frontline treatment of CML in treatment naive patients. This is as per the DASISION trial. Dasatinib administered once daily as compared with imatinib administered once daily induced significantly higher and faster rates of complete cytological response and major molecular response. It can be the choice of TKI over imatinib and nilotinib since CNS penetration is there. So this is CNS penetration. Dasatinib is the choice of therapy. It is also a choice of therapy patients with cardiovascular, liver, diabetes patients. So therefore, these patients also would not have any side effects with dasatinib. One side effect of dasatinib, which all of us have to remember, is you can get pleural effusion. It can be bilateral or even unilateral. It can be very troublesome pleural effusion. If after 2-3 times, if you got these kind of pleural effusions, you may need to discontinue and change the TKI. This is one of the side effects, which because it's not always hunky-dory, this is one of the practical things that I can actually tell you on that. If you're having a TKI, if you have pleural effusion, after one or two times, if you dose reduce and you cut the, you stop treatment for some time and again restart it, if it reoccurs, you might need to change the agent. Apart from that, the treatment of CML has changed to a very large extent over the last 20 years. We have new molecules which are coming in now. We have even third generation drugs which have also come. And the treatment spectrum is actually very exciting, and it is they're going to have more new drugs in the pipeline which are coming, which are going to keep, which has already imatinib and second generation drugs have made CML like any other comorbidity like diabetes or hypertension. You just keep popping in pills, keep swapping pills, and then afterwards you're good to go. And the patients don't even need to be told that they have a dangerous disease like a blood cancer. That's how treatment has changed. Thank you very much. I'd love to take any questions if there are any. Or back to the organizers.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an insightful session. There are a couple of questions I would like to ask. Like when we talk about the CML prognostic tools, so what according to you, like which tool do you more commonly use, like Sokal score or UTOS or the Hasford score? Which is the most common score which you use as a
prognostic? Actually, Sokal score was what was used for a long time, but then we realized that Sokal score is not very specific and it doesn't give us such a good value. So right now, UTOS score is what has been recommended by ELN, that is European Leukemia Network, and that is the score that we use. So many patients who come on so-called score high risk actually turn out to be UTA score low risk or intermediate risk. So both of them have their own pluses and minuses. But the oldest has been the so-called score. If you don't do any score, at least so-called score, but everything is now, it's app-based or it's a algorithm-based. It's all available online. You put in the key in the patient details and you get your score comes out.
Yes, sir. Sir, and like in this COVID era, is there any change in the treatment recommendation or the protocol for the newly diagnosed CML patients?
Actually, when you're doing the therapy remains the same. This is one of the most easiest diseases to treat. So when you're doing in the COVID era, biggest fear is the patient can't come to hospital on a regular basis. We're doing most of them are by teleconsultation. We get ask them to get their CBCs done at home, and then we monitor. We either reduce the dose or interrupt the dose for some time, and we get the patient back. Our practice has not changed much, but we if the patient has a progression, we don't want the patient to get perturbed that he can't come to hospital. Hence, we would like to put them on a second line TKI like dasatinib or nilotinib upfront itself, so the patient has a very good response and needing to come to hospital for a longer duration of time.
And like as a part of remote monitoring, so what do you like usually use?
Right now we are as a part of remote monitoring, we are doing I go to Siliguri. So Siliguri is in North Bengal and it's very close to Assam border. So I have a lot of patients over there with CML. Right now, all we are doing is only CBCs and we are monitoring the patients and adjusting the dose accordingly. But if I find that the patient is having new symptoms or if he's having any, the counts are actually dipping too much, then I reduce the count, I reduce the dose or interrupt the dose. If the counts are jumping up, either from 400 imatinib, I made it into 800 imatinib. If the patient is on dasatinib, then after that, I have to increase the dose of that. It's difficult for them to get a imatinib resistance mutation analysis, IRMA test done right now, but it's many places are yet open and some people are able to do it, and the people who can't afford to do it or who can't afford to keep coming and medical care is thing there, it is quite a challenge that how do we handle those patients. But overall we're doing well and most of the patients are well controlled.
And like, is there any interaction between the CML, the treatment which we are using for CML and the medicines which we are trying for the COVID? Is there any data on any interaction, drug interaction?
Well, there is any drug, whichever we use, whenever using this remdesivir or if we're using favipiravir, whenever we are using that, there will be some form of interactions which will, because this is cytochrome P34A inhibitors. So therefore you will have some amount, the drug dosages need to be changed whenever you're doing this. So there's a chance that you might either have a little bit more toxicity on the CML front, that is the counts might fall further, or there may be a loss of efficacy of these drugs. So therefore you might actually need to increase the dose of these drugs. That needs to be monitored. Yes.
Is a question from Dr. Srinivas Rao. One of my patients is in chronic phase on prednisolone alone for years, and he developed paraparesis. Imaging and CSF analysis were normal. Could it be a paraneoplastic syndrome?
It could be, sir. But one important thing about the paraparesis is it's very strange. We'll have to look for, like Dr. Rao has mentioned, that the imaging is clear. Otherwise, you will naturally think of some kind of a deposit which has occurred over the spine, which is causing some amount of compression, like a myeloid sarcoma, like we said, if it goes into an accelerated phase. It is important now for us to see whether there's been a myelogenous deposit in the spine. CSF may not be positive all the times, because if it comes positive, well and good. If not, it could be just like a myelogenous deposit which might have occurred. So in these kind of situations, it is important for us to do the BCR-ABL international score, see if he's lost his cytogenetic response, a major molecular response, major MMR has been lost. And in such a situation, you might have to shift over to tier 2 or a second generation TKI or third generation TKI if he's on a second generation one.
Okay, so That's all are the questions from the audience. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for being with us today and for your precious time. Have a great evening.
Thank you. Thank you. You too. And thank you to all the audience who've been watching us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Bye. Jai Hind.